It's really my pleasure to be here today. And as I said, I'm about a half an hour from here. So I'm just delighted to be able to address you today. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself and a little bit about what I do, and then we're going to dive into the topic of embryo adoption. I have been in this area really all my life. I am married and have four children. One of my children is an adopted daughter, and when I adopted her in 1999, I really felt that when I was able to go back to work when my babies were old enough, that I was being just really, really driven hard by the Lord that I needed to be involved in the ministry of adoption. And so I was thrilled to be able to do one of those reinventions of yourself when I was in my 30s, and to start and begin to do the work of adoption. And I am a member of LCMS Church in Des Moines, Iowa, and was really very excited to find Lutheran Family Service, which is a recognized service organization of the LCMS Church, to do my work in adoption. It felt like coming home, because there are many aspects to adoption that is important as a ministry, that we stay true to ourselves and our doctrine. So I was really very excited to be a part of that. So I have staff here in Iowa. I'm going to tell you just briefly about the programs that I am responsible for, and then we're going to dive into embryo adoption. But I have a staff here in Iowa so that we can reach out to this entire state. So myself, Emily, Audrey, and Carrie are able to handle the area of pregnancy counseling and adoption. And so I'm very grateful to have them. And we've most recently opened up in the Quad Cities area, which Scott County, for those of you that are familiar with Iowa, does have. Are you from that area? I did not realize. Okay, so there's a pretty high abortion rate in Scott County based on that population. And so we try and be strategic about where we place our folks. And so that office has opened up, and at the end of summer, we will be having a grand opening. So if you are around in that area, well, you're in Connecticut, so you might want to come back for our grand opening. Yes.
4 days in July.
Right, right. So we're very excited about that, and our next endeavor will likely be in the Council Bluffs area, so we're looking forward to that. But I want to tell you just a little, very, very briefly, the history of Lutheran Family Service dates way back to 1901, and I'm betting in this room full of folks, there might be someone here that speaks a little German. Maybe? Yeah? Read it for me so I don't slaughter it, will you?
Lutheranisch Kinderfreund Gesellschaft.
Thank you so much. So that the Lutheran Home Finding Society was founded in 1901, and really the beginning of our endeavors at Lutheran Family Service was to take care of the orphans. And there were a number of orphans in that time frame. And eventually this home here was built in the 1930s. That's in Fort Dodge. And we still own that property today. As a matter of fact, that property has been used for many different things, including an orphanage, then later a maternity home, later a home that would house the intellectually disabled, and then most recently it's been remodeled and it's used as a ministry center. So I'm sure if you folks ever have an occasion to want to have a stay at the orphanage, which is now called the ministry center, we would love to have you there. So we use that for all of our congregations that are in Iowa. There are around 3,000 children who have been placed for adoption through Lutheran Family Service here in Iowa, and we're responsible for those records and for taking care of the needs of all of those adopted folks and their birth mothers who placed them for adoption. So we also will go back and do some matching and some reunions and so forth. So we're very, very much tied to our history. Very briefly, pregnancy counseling for our program here in Iowa would include that we serve all women who are throughout Iowa who find themselves pregnant and in need of care. And we provide services such as making parenting plans or making adoption plans, depending upon what the need of the woman would be. We do not refer for abortion, which I'm sure does not surprise you. Our purpose for doing what we do is to have an effect on the abortion rate in Iowa, to obviously lessen that and hopefully someday make it unthinkable. But providing service for women who are in, that are pregnant or in need of our help. And sometimes that does lead to an adoption plan. So our counseling does extend beyond our placement of children. It also extends to, so if we have a placement, that we stick by their side, and we do that in one of two ways. As pregnancy counselors, we can continue to assist with grief and with loss. But sometimes we have folks that are maybe have a multitude of problems mentally, mental health speaking as well, and that may compound some things. We do have master level trained counselors throughout Iowa, and mental health counseling is a big part of what we do as well. So we will connect with them in that way if need be. And then we also provide intensive retreats for the loss and the feeling of grief that can be associated with placing children. And we do that at the ministry center that I was showing you before. One of the things that we try to do is to really create local partnerships. Rather than creating the same situation over and over again and redoing what's already being served here in Iowa, we partner with organizations like Informed Choices or Agape or Inner Visions, just to name a few. There are several all over Iowa, and these are medically based pregnancy counseling centers who are doing ultrasounds and providing STD testing. And then, so we make a connection with them by providing lots of really good adoption training for them so that their staff and their volunteers understand adoption and what the law is in Iowa and so forth. We make those connections with them, so if they have clients that need to be seen and need to be assisted by our organization, that we can come alongside them. So we've created lots of great partnerships. And then all of these services are, of course, done at no cost to the woman. We're free, we'll travel anywhere they are and meet any need that they may have. So the adoption options that we offer at Lutheran Family Service include domestic infant adoption, which means a child that was born here in Iowa in one of the Iowa hospitals, that we would place as a newborn infant into a family, an adopted family's home. We also provide some services with international adoption, and we also provide services in embryo adoption, which is the topic that I'm going to get to here in just a moment. We'll dive right into that one with some more specifics. But at Lutheran Family Service, we do require that if an adoptive family wants to work with our organization, this is a Christian ministry, and we do have some specific things that are important to us to make sure that we're providing the best home possible for the children that we're serving. And that would be that a couple has been married for at least 3 years, that they've been active in a Christian congregation, they're in good mental and physical health. It needs to be a male-female couple. And all of the decisions that we're making are going to be based on what the needs are for that child, not necessarily what are the needs of the couple that's coming to us and seeking our assistance. So now with that, I want to talk to you just a little bit about embryo adoption. That specific program is what I'm here to talk about today. I imagine you're somewhat familiar with embryo adoption because I certainly know that your group has embraced the idea of embryo adoption, and so you know a little bit about it. But let me give you a few particulars in case there's anyone that is unsure exactly of what happens. Embryo adoption is something that happens in response to children who have been created through the process of in vitro fertilization. In vitro fertilization is a fertility treatment for those who may have infertility. And during that treatment, gametes, male and female, are joined together in a petri dish. And that would be what we call conception, right? And we all know life begins at right. So what's been created in that petri dish, even though it looks very different than you and me as grown adults, is a life. And what happens is that sometimes folks create these embryos in attempt to have a family of their own. And because they cannot foresee the future, they do not know how many embryos are going to be created at one time. They're unable to know what will happen with the potential pregnancies and the children to be born, how many there might be. They're unable to predict their own futures as to would one of them pass away, would they become divorced. There are several things that would certainly mean that perhaps those children that have been created might not be able to be implanted and be born. So those are, what creates then is sometimes there are embryos that, for lack of a better word, are left over. And those embryos are then frozen in time in cryobanks. And what becomes of them from there is unknown. They might be able to have an opportunity to be a part of their genetic family, and they may not. Yes. Well, embryo would be the creation of the two gametes, so sperm and egg, that have been united. So this is a fertilized person. this is the beginning of conception. So as for there are different terminologies that go along with this different stages of development, and I would have to look those up for you to be accurate. So I should be very specific. I am not a scientist. I am a social worker. So I apologize for not being able to give you more clarity than that, but an embryo is the conception has happened. Oh, well, many weeks into development, I'd have to, again, with the technical, as far as scientific terms, I'd have to.
We have a doctor. Take it.
Yes.
Eight weeks.
Thank you. 8 weeks. So far into, we're a pregnancy. So we're talking about just very few cell development at the point that we're talking about in the petri dish and being frozen. And I'll get a little bit more into the transfer and so forth here in a little bit, but 8 weeks in development would be then a fetus. So how this works is Lutheran Family Service is connected with Nightlight in that we provide the social work services and they provide the matching of the embryos, the shipping, and so forth. And I'll explain that a little bit here in a little bit. But we're connected with this organization, which is also a Christian organization.
Nightlight embryo adoption, snowflake adoption was born because of the compassion of an LCMS couple in California.
Yep.
Who were the first to adopt an embryo, and so they were the pilots for this program, which has developed. So embryo adoption is associated with the Lutheran Church of Missouri Synod from its beginning.
Yes, it was. That's a Strege family, and I've been on the phone with them actually this week, and we're in hopes to have maybe a little cameo Skype visit at a fundraising dinner here with Miss Hannah Strege, who is 18 this year. So she was the first snowflake baby to be born in the United States, and she's turned 18 this year. So there are said to be over 4,500 children in the United States that have been born through embryo adoption. And we're happy to be a part of that here in Iowa, though I'll tell you, I wish our numbers were a lot larger than they are. There are some difficulties in getting this program off the ground, as it does seem like weird science to a lot of people. But we know that we've got a lot of couples that are struggling with infertility, that are making decisions towards fertility treatments and so forth, that we certainly, our goal is to have an awareness for those couples as this being a possibility for them to have children in their future. But as you've already learned through the video, these embryos are being created with families who are struggling with infertility. These embryos are not being created in order that they might be sold and create a market for the idea of embryo adoption, at least not through Nightlight and what the program is that we're involved in. But this is also largely not a regulated area for the law. So it'll be interesting to see where things head. So one of the things in the video that you might have noticed is that they were talking in terms of the donor family, which is an interesting term, don't you think? Anybody else adopted a child? Was your birth mom the donor? I don't know. I think it's a very interesting term. But one of the things I wanted to bring up about the reason I believe that they're using that term is because it can be very, very confusing. In the IVF process, many, many times, there are going to be gametes that are used from you've got a couple, a married couple that are trying to create a child, but they may not have an appropriate egg to be utilized, and they may be purchasing eggs from someone else. They might be purchasing sperm from someone else so that making this process of these embryos they've created inappropriate necessarily to call them the genetic family. So does that make sense to you? Is that genetically they are not necessarily related to each of the couple or maybe either of the couple, but they would be the owners of those embryos. And so in this sense, the idea of using the term donating family helps to sort of explain who it is that we're talking about without using inappropriate terms. So as you can imagine, if you were a couple that was faced with maybe you had 15 eggs extracted at the time that you were preparing for IVF, and you'd already determined that you hope to implant two during the fresh cycle, Well, there are going to be 13 more lives that you need to make a decision about. And so there's the first level of decision, and many of those embryos will be determined to freeze. Other embryos might be determined to be destroyed at that time, and that's based on, you know, the scientists that are involved that are evaluating those embryos. But for those who are frozen, there are choices that couples are going to need to make as time progresses. And for some, they maybe want to have more children and more pregnancies, and they will use the embryos that are being kept in cryo-freezers, and they will thaw those embryos and attempt an additional pregnancy. But for those couples, especially those who create lots of embryos, sometimes that isn't possible. That the idea that they're going to try and implant them and have an additional pregnancy, for whatever reason, that choice is off the table. And then there becomes a really difficult choice ahead for this family as to what's next. So they could keep them frozen indefinitely, and certainly the cost to do this is going to be different, you know, between many different facilities. But let's say maybe $600 to $700 a year to accomplish that, and then still not having a plan moving forward, but keeping them frozen because we don't know what else to do. Another possibility would be just to discard them, to thaw them and discard them, which would obviously be destruction of life. Another choice they would have would be to surrender them for scientific research, which means that they would be thawed, they would be researched, and then they would be killed and destroyed. So the last option that they would have would be to donate them to another couple who would be willing to receive them and to implant them and to hope for pregnancy and for a child to be born. So you can see by the options that are here that there are not great options before you if you're not able to have and implant all of the embryos that are created. And the one option that is life-affirming would be to find another family who would be willing to do this. So how are embryos donated? How does this whole thing work? Did you have a question?
I did.
Yes.
You, on that last box,
yeah.
So are individuals going in and asking for these, or I know you're not doing that in your process, but obviously it's happening.
Absolutely. So overall, just in broad strokes with embryo adoption, certainly there are agencies that would absolutely do that for an individual. And that it brings up a great point. I mean, there are all sorts of things that govern our home study on whether or not we'll accept a couple. But one in our particular agency, they have to be a male-female couple to do that. So lots of these slides are actually given to me.
Sure,
so.
Sure.
So how are embryos donated? There are a few options, and some of them are going to seem really crazy to you, but it is truly accurate. And here in Iowa, it's happened where a family has connected with another family. So a donor family and a receiving family connected with each other on Craigslist. And so they made their transaction on Craigslist. So they made their transaction way outside of the realm of any social work, they would have had to have some sort of an attorney to draw up some legal papers of transfer of property, but they made these decisions based on meeting each other on Craigslist, and, you know, this is possible. This is not illegal to do, and it certainly would be one way to go about it, but it does really circumvent all of the things that we know is best practice in adoption. So it's, to me, a little bit scary, but it does happen. There is also going to be programs in fertility clinics for embryo adoption. But these, interestingly, are also going to circumvent any sort of social work surrounding this, and they're all done anonymously. So if I had embryos left over that I wanted to donate, I could choose to donate them to my doctor who helped me. And that doctor will say, okay, well, medically speaking, all of the information about my genetics, my husband's genetics, all the medical stuff is going to go with this embryo, and that information will be given, but our identities aren't going to be given, and those are not things that we're going to know where embryos go, or if they stay within our own community, or do we have children here that we don't, yeah, all of those things are sort of unknown to you if you choose to go the path through the fertility clinic, because the fertility clinic is very interested on the medical side, obviously, but they're not social workers, and so they're not really getting into the idea of that this is an adoption. Embryo adoption agency would be the other option that you would have for embryo adoption. And this is what we're reflecting here with the program that we have at Lutheran Family Service in connection with Snowflake's Nightlight Adoption Program. So what happens in these instances is embryo adoption agency is going to help, first of all, they're going to receive donated embryos, and which means that they're going to be working on making a match with a receiving family. And so they will go through a process of getting to know receiving families and getting to know donating families about what are they looking for in order to match each other up in an appropriate way. So lots of factors go into that. He spoke a little bit about the video of that, but I think that really interestingly for our families, a lot of the things are how many embryos are we talking about? So if we're talking about a group of embryos that's maybe 8 or 10, then if we had a couple that maybe is childless right now and they're thinking, yes, they really would like to have a large family, then that might be an appropriate match. If we had a family that maybe had 4 or 5 children already and they said, we just really want to do this, we want to rescue an embryo, and we could have one more child, it would be not as appropriate to match them with 8 or 10 embryos that could create 8 or 10 or more human beings, but rather maybe a smaller amount of embryos would make more sense in that situation. So there are lots of factors that are going to go into that match and that discussion, the receiving family is really hoping for and what the donating family is also looking for as well.
So maybe I'm thinking about this wrong from what you said, but if the frozen embryos are thawed and there's several of them put inside a family, like you mentioned, the second scenario of a family, they think they want just one more and they can do that, but they put several in, can those embryos be refrozen, then if they don't work?
I completely understand the question, and I think I've misled you down a path. There could be a group of, say, 8 or 10 embryos, but they are not all in one group together frozen. So they're going to be in straws. Maybe there are 2 that go into each little straw. So the group as a property might now belong to this receiving couple. But at the time that they prepare her for transfer, they may say, we will only transfer 2 at a time. And so they will thaw 1 straw that has 2 embryos in it, and then they would be implanted. And then later, they would be achieving later pregnancies that they would thaw those remaining embryos. So they would still stay in a frozen state. Does that make sense? So yes, I know it is. It does seem like strange science, but yes, in the back.
Okay, so these 2 have been implanted. Now, a viable pregnancy occurs, a child is born, but there are more embryos. Whose embryos are they?
Right.
Are they the new family, the adopting family? Are they the donor family?
Right.
And then they can still be kept frozen indefinitely?
Yes. So the answers to your question are they would become the property of the receiving family prior to any implantation. Okay, so the legal work comes first, they get shipped, they are now the property of that receiving family, but they also have agreements to say, let's say out of those 8 embryo group that's transferred, that the family has thawed and implanted 6 of those embryos, 2 remain, but they were very, very fertile and lucky, and the Lord has his hand on this, and they have 6 children now. And they're, okay, we don't know that we can do 2 more. That agreement that was originally in place is going to transfer that property, those 2 remaining embryos, back to the original donating family, and Nightlife will continue to work with a 3rd match in order for those embryos also to have an opportunity at life. So they've really set up for those scenarios because clearly we cannot predict the future. And it's unknown even to our receiving families whether or not they'll be able to fully commit to the idea of all the embryos that they receive. That's the intent when they start. And the intent when they start also is that they will never reduce a pregnancy. So those things are discussed in terms of how many embryos would be transferred at one time, what's safe for them to do, because we can have surprises, right? The Lord is good. And one of our really good surprises here in Iowa, and this pastor has been very vocal, you know, on the local news and so forth. So I don't feel, I mean, normally I wouldn't tell you client names, but Pastor Tim and his wife went through this program and implanted two embryos, and one of those embryos split. And so they have three beautiful children from embryo adoption born a couple of years ago. So those things certainly happen. We just can't predict.
Now in other adoptions, my husband and I adopted our boys. I mean, there's always the option if your child wants to find out their birth family, they can at least attempt that. Is there anything in place for these? I mean, if there were numerous
right.
embryos that they can go back?
Yes. So it depends on how the connections were made. So if they were made through Craigslist, maybe they have, you know, they obviously made a connection at some point, and so they might continue to make their own connections. If it was done through a fertility clinic, the answer is no, because they do not pass any sort of identifying information. They look at this more as genetic material, not as family donation or adoption. If we're talking about a program like this through an agency, most certainly those things are set in place. Now, it does not mean that every family has to be in connection all the time, sharing pictures, letters, and videos, and meeting up once a year. There's a whole spectrum on how people get to know each other and decide they want to interact or they don't want to interact, but those possibilities all exist. Yeah, that's the whole point, is that they know where all the siblings are. And absolutely, yes, and that's part of the whole process of making sure that any of those embryos that remain that have gone to a donating family are going to come back under the control of that originating family, and with the agency's help to get them donated to an additional, and that way all of the siblings are known, because these are full blood siblings, and it's a good idea for and many aspects for them to know where everybody's at and who they are. Yes?
I heard you say that it's not well regulated. It doesn't sound like it's regulated at all legally. So it sounds like
right.
there's some future things that could be happening.
Right.
Because there's certainly a need for this. But, you know, obviously through the in vitro fertilization, this has been a product of that. Because back in the day when they were doing terrible amounts or terrific amounts of selective reduction.
Right.
But is selective reduction still taking place?
I would assume that it is. I'm not a medical doctor, but I would absolutely assume that it would be something that a fertility doctor would address with a woman, you know, especially like the example I just gave, is carrying triplets is not, you know, I mean, that's pretty big deal. So, you know, I have no idea what the discussions were like in, you know, specifics, but my assumption would be that they are still on the table as discussion. Would you agree, doctor? Yes.
What about that couple, though, that just wanted one more child, and you said two are in a tube and they implant two?
Right, so there would be a possibility of a twin pregnancy, but not all are, but there are, see, there are, right, see, they,
how about both embryos take inside?
Right.
And she only just really wanted one.
It would be an inappropriate match. So sometimes there are embryos, there's just one embryo. That's all there is. There are donating couples that have one, there are donated couples that have two or three and so forth. All of that is making sure during the matching process that we have an appropriate situation for what the couple is desiring.
Ah, there's the
yeah, absolutely. So you can see there's some social work involved, right? Or potentially it might be a good idea to have some social work involved. So there's 612 embryos the last time there was a census taken, and that would be, I'm sure, at least 5 years ago. Right now it's estimated to be over 1 million embryos that are in the United States. Research shows us that about 6% of those are at a point where the families are, you know, would be looking for a receiving family if there was one to find. So not all 612,000 embryos that are in the freezers in the United States today are needing a family, because they may have, their family is very much, you know, waiting for the next pregnancy to occur, or the timing and that type of thing. But about 6% would be available for adoption.
Well,
basically, how does this process get started? Here in Iowa, if there was a couple that was thinking that they might like to receive embryos to attempt an embryo adoption, we also refer to it as embryo rescue, because our point in being involved in this is those children who are in freezers. it is not necessarily because of our heart for infertility, and we do have a heart for infertility, but that isn't the point for what it is we're trying to do. We're trying to understand that these little children are one of the biggest tribes in the United States that have never had that ability to hear and learn about Jesus Christ, to be baptized, and to be born as God had intended. And so that is really our purpose in doing what we do. But people start, they can start with checking out our website and giving us a call at Lutheran Family Service. And we're going to provide them with some basic information and a consultation about whether or not this is, you know, a good idea for them. They are going to need to provide some confirmation from their physician that this would be an appropriate avenue for them to pursue. So many people think, well, if I'm suffering with infertility because I have a cycle that is unusual or has a few hiccups, I'm probably not a candidate to do this. Well, the truth is, really what you need is a healthy uterus. You don't necessarily need to have a healthy cycle. So it is obviously the physician that needs to say whether or not a woman is capable of carrying a child and whether this would be a procedure she should go through. So we would ask for that. And then we would make a connection with the Nightlight Snowflake Adoption Program to make sure that they also feel that this couple would be an acceptable couple. So this is sort of a registration type process. And then really from there, what we do is we complete a home study, just like we would for any other adopting couple. So all of the different laws and all the different aspects of adoption, when it comes to the social work and the preparation and the education, are all going to be in place. So it's usually about 80% education and talking to people about how you prepare for the idea of what's going to be happening, as well as how do you prepare for the future with a child who is learning their story and to how they came to be a part of your family. And then we also do all the rest of the pieces of home study where we're making sure that they're not pedophiles, they don't have a criminal background that would not allude them to be wonderful parents. And we go through all of the different stages of, you know, talking about their marriage and their stability, their financial makeup of the family, and whether or not this would be a burden financially that just really would, you know, hurt a family. But really going through all of those same steps that we go with any traditional adoption. So they would choose a fertility clinic during this process so that work can begin to be connected with them. And then they would create a profile book. Are y'all familiar when I say profile book? If maybe you're familiar with somewhat of domestic adoption and what that's like. Shutterfly books would be a really good example of really what within the pages they're going to have pictures as well as text that are going to explain a little bit about their family. So, if they have children already or what kinds of activities they like to be involved in or if they're travelers, what kind of jobs they have, that kind of thing. So really giving just a general idea of the family. And then they're waiting to be matched. And it is, in general terms, predicted to be about a six-month process for them to be matched with embryos. So the first part of that matching process is going to be with a person at Nightlight who's going to say, okay, well, this family is saying they really only want to have one child and that's really the maximum that they could do. So they would be looking at embryo sets that would be one, you know, and also all the other aspects of what they might be looking for. But the interesting part about the match is that it is the donating family that's going to have the first priority as to where those babies are going to go. So they will be given profile books that would match any of their specifications. Sometimes it's religion or race, or there could be a whole host of things. But they will go through those profile books and they will say, yes, it could be that one or that one or that one. Tell this couple yes, and if they say no or they reject us, then they go back to sort of their fallback couples and so forth. So it's this whole process, but the process itself can take about 6 months to get through. So as I mentioned, our role would be to complete the home study, to do the training and education of that family, to assist in their profile book and do some ongoing guidance throughout the process. And Snowflake's role would be to match the clients with the genetic parents who have embryos to donate. They would also assist those couples with whatever kind of communication they decided they wanted to have. Sometimes they do it on their own. Sometimes they sort of communicate through an agency. There really can be a variety of ways that gets done. And they will also manage the legal transaction, the property transfer. So I'm sure on the video you picked up on the fact that this is not really an adoption in the sense of that we're going to have an adoption decree when we're done, right? What we actually have is a property transfer by the owners of those embryos, which is that original family. And then that property transfer, that legal work, will then transfer those to the receiving family. So even though this is a property transfer, it is considered to be a special property transfer in that no money can change hands between the receiving and donating families. So it's truly a donation. Now, that's not to say that there hasn't been all sorts of money that has traded hands over times. In the beginning, about perhaps even buying gametes, eggs, or sperm from someone else, that costs money. The money that is also spent on keeping the embryos in a freezer, the money that it takes to do the social work to prepare for this adoption, the money that it takes to, medically speaking, to implant and so forth. But there can be no exchange between that receiving family and that donating family. That's really where, I guess, it's to really kind of keep that from driving a market, you know, so they're not created in order to be adopted. And then they also handle the shipping of the embryos to the fertility clinic. So here's a little picture, a little snapshot for you, if you will, about what the kind of expense would be involved if you were a family who wanted to receive embryos donated to you. Lutheran Family Service, in order to do the social work that we do and writing the reports that we do, which include that education and that pre-work, and then also one post-adoption visit as well after birth of the baby or babies. $2,600 to be paid to Lutheran Family Service. The Snowflake program fee is $8,000. The frozen transfer, the medical things, are somewhere between $2,500 and $5,000. And then the estimate total would be $13,000 to $16,000. And obviously that doesn't also cover the medical expenses and insurance needed and prenatal care and all those types of things. So, but that gives you an idea. And just as a side note here, one of the, as Pastor Licht mentioned earlier, we've been working together on a few things that we kind of call, for lack of a better word, our voice in the public square. And we're working on end-of-life issues and so forth. But one of those that has fallen to me is this year, one of our legislative agendas is to get, we have an adoption tax credit here in Iowa of $5,000. So what our hope is that we can get embryo adoption listed as an adoption where that tax credit can also take place in order to alleviate a little bit of the financial pressure of the expense of embryo adoption. So we'll see if we're successful this year, but that'll be one of our goals. You know, we talked about this already throughout the questions about embryos being considered property and not people and how that law and that works. So we'll skip through that. A frozen embryo transfer can be done in a couple of ways. One, a woman can actually have her cycle altered through medication for the doctor so that she and her womb are prepared for that transfer. But it also can be timed so that her natural cycle is taking place and that implantation can take place just at the right time. So the FET is the frozen embryo transfer. That's actually the transfer of those embryos who have been thawed and will be placed in the womb of the receiving mother. So each clinic has a unique survival rate when it comes to thawing. It ranges somewhere between 50 and 85%. And I've been told through my research in the process that most of the deaths that occur are really occurring in the freezing process through some crystallization that is unfortunate, but it isn't recognized that those embryos have actually perished until they're thawed. And so I just wanted to give you an idea of what that is. So this is not 100%, and there can be some real disappointing things in that process.
So in yes. this case, say a family wants one embryo, so they're going to thaw one, and they find out the little embryo's already died.
Right.
So now you're all waiting. Well, now you're going to have to wait till next month, and they're going to thaw another one. They're going to do this one at a time, right?
Absolutely. Yes. Well, for those who are doing that through our process, through Nightlight, all of that education is going to take place about what is life affirming. Now, when we're talking about embryo adoption in general, no, not necessarily. And so none of that is.
Five and hope they're going to get two. Right. And that's just how
it is when
you're messing with this stuff, right?
Yes. You don't know, right? Yeah. Those would be some of the dangers. You know, I would certainly hope that fertility doctors are very careful because some people aren't going to look at this as life like we do, right? But they're also going to look at it as valuable property. So they, I mean, even if they didn't necessarily look at it at life, they would be like, what a waste, right? Why would I thaw five if I only intend to implant three? So there would be processes in place that people may feel like there's value there, even though it isn't the same type of value that we see because these are God's creations. Yes.
Do they do testing of the embryos after they're thawed?
Before
implantation to cull those that are less healthy or?
Those would be done during the process of in vitro fertilization before the very first, so the originating couple. Those embryos are going to be created and they're going to be graded and they're going to be researched to some degree before they are ever frozen. So they would choose what they would consider to be the most premier, I don't know what the right word is, that look the healthiest or whatever. And we're not talking about sex or anything like that because it's unknown at that point because the cells have not gotten that far to be able to recognize that. But they will be looking at certain features of the embryo and make a determination and they will grade each one of them. So when they are received by a family, they do know what those grades are. Yes, that is correct. And that is the way they do this. It's a survival rate and they say basically each clinic. So this isn't like a big global number. You know, that's why it's such a range there between 50 and 85%
is. That number could drop after.
Absolutely. I'm not saying it's not possible for an embryo to die during the thaw process, but what my understanding and the research shows is that the death likely occurred during that process of freezing because there's some crystallization that can happen. And I think they've perfected that quite a bit over time. But this is a success rate before you even start with implantation. Okay, so there's a different number when it comes to the actual transfer. So let's say that the embryos that were thawed were healthy, they were implanted. The success rate then for pregnancy is going to be 35% chance of pregnancy. And interestingly enough, just in our normal sexual behavior, 34% chance of pregnancy is the number. So I don't know why that, I mean, obviously it's very close to being the same, but it's kind of interesting to note. So it usually will take about 2 weeks before pregnancy is going to be known about what after that transfer takes place.
So that 35% would be, let's say they implant two and one of them survives. Is that considered a 50% or is it considered 100% because at least they have one surviving child?
I don't know the answer to that question, Renee, right? Yes, I don't know the answer to that question on how those statistics were derived, so I can't answer that. That's interesting.
Just to tweak that just a little, when we talk about that, you mentioned that the natural pregnancy rate is 34%. That's because a sexually active couple is going to continue to produce every so often a little fertilized egg, which is your embryo, and they don't all come out. I mean, they don't all implant.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a God thing. To, you know, a miscarriage or a failure to failure to implant does not mean you didn't conceive. It means you never got a baby. So 2/3 of the time, I didn't know that number till now,
mm-hmm.
But 2/3 of the time, we're losing those little embryos in a natural, God-given way because they didn't implant, or the uterus couldn't hold them, or we might lose them at 2 months, or 4 months, or 5 months. That's all part of the natural thing that we're talking about. This is when man mm-hmm. mixes his knowledge with our biology. So there's a lot of stuff going on there, but.
Mm-hmm.
It happens naturally as well, just so you know that.
Right. Did you have a question, too?
Question, no.
No. comment.
Several thousand points to make.
Okay.
I'll try to limit myself just to one. It's very important in all of these topics that we use as precise language as possible, especially because there are communities of people that are using imprecise language on purpose so as to cloud the issue. So we need to be champions of precise language. And so what happens when an embryo is thawed and then put into a womb is called transfer. Okay. Then there is an additional process called implantation, which is directed by the embryo. Okay, so that's a two-step process. We cannot implant embryos. Embryos implant mm-hmm. themselves in the lining of the womb, right? All we can do is transfer, so we can take it out of the straw and place it via a process that's strikingly similar to those of you who are familiar with animal husbandry. It's pretty much exactly the same as that, only using some specialized instruments, but that is transfer. Okay, implantation then takes place after that. Just want to mm-hmm. clarify that, so we're all talking about exactly the same thing.
Very good.
Are there labs doing genetic monitoring of the embryos before they do implantation so they can make sure that there are, quote unquote, the proper sex, no genetic problems, stuff along that line?
So the grading of an embryo really happens at the point that they were originally created, so before they were frozen. After they come back to the clinic, there's going to be some obviously very basic things that need to be done to make sure that they are still living and so forth. And, you know, they have the proper embryos for the proper person. So that transfer process, that shipping and all of that is something that Nightlight would have taken care of with that clinic. Pastor.
Since you raised the topic.
Yes.
I had always thought that the grading of embryos was a very scientific, kind of hocus-pocus, magic, lots of testing involved. It's not. Grading of embryos happens like this. The fertility doc looks at the embryo under a microscope and says, yep, looks good, or yep, looks bad. I mean, really, that's it. It has to do with the shape of the cells at the blastocyst stage and maybe the proportions of things, but it's not highly scientific. So here is a fertility doctor who's issuing a thumbs up or thumbs down on the life of this embryo simply based on a glance under the microscope. There is no other,
are there labs that are talking about
them? There are laboratory tests that you can do genetic testing on embryos. Here's the problem.
We do that in animals quite often.
In order to do that, you run the risk of damaging the embryo so that it can't recover because you need to remove tissue mm-hmm. to test. And at the blastocyst stage, which is two cells, mm-hmm. yeah, there's not a whole lot to take. Mm-hmm. So,
a little bit more than that.
Well, yeah, they test anywhere between the 2 and 8 cell stage, and you know, if you can imagine taking 20% of your body mass, mm-hmm. now, embryos are remarkably plastic. They can overcome those things, but you endanger the survival of the embryo by subjecting it to this genetic testing. So those of us who are Christians who value even this embryonic life as a person created by God, we have serious ethical problems mm-hmm. with doing that kind of damage to an embryo at that stage.
It's coming.
It's already here.
We can do that in mice without any trouble. And that's one of my areas of expertise.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And we do a lot of that to make sure that we get the right genetic material mm-hmm. and sex and stuff along that line. And so it's coming.
The problem is there's only one way for us to perfect that technique on human beings, and that's
mm-hmm.
by screwing up,
mm-hmm.
which we have an ethical problem with, mm-hmm. right? So
exactly.
Somebody else will do it. We don't have to agree with it.
if it can be thought of and dreamt of, somebody's going to do it, right? Was there a question in the back?
Yes. Do you do counseling as far as if the embryos, once they start developing, are not perfect, that it right. isn't the option of, well, now we can now have an abortion because the baby isn't perfect?
Those are really done before. So in part of our education during the home study process, we'd be talking about those things, about what would be done, what would be, you know, what are their feelings, where, what would they do when. And we will stay connected with the family throughout the pregnancy if they desire us to be. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. You know, I mean, there's obviously a 9-month process that's going on there, and we've already vetted them as a family, and they really generally go through this as just as a typical pregnancy that they would with a child that they conceived together. In a more natural process, but absolutely, if there are concerns and so forth and they keep us involved, we would certainly do that. Yes?
I may have missed this, but before the embryo is implanted, do you
transferred.
Transferred.
Sorry.
Sorry. That's a good point.
That's why I'm here to learn. Do you know what the sex is?
No. No, it's too early to know the gender. So it will.
What stage?
Doctor, you want to tell me what stage the gender is determined? I'm so sorry. Scientifically, I'm not your man.
It's already there. It's whether or not you're going to take material out to find out what it is.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
That's where genetic monitoring.
So you know, but are you going to do that?
Right. Well, in these particular cases, those tests have not been done on the embryos that are available for donation, at least through this process that I'm talking about. So there would be no knowledge of gender for these donating families or the receiving families. Yes?
Do you have, I don't want to ask questions if you have more to go.
Go ahead, no
okay.
problem.
You're in Iowa. Are all the states, do each, I know in St. Louis we have Lutheran Child, whatever the initials are, do they do the same counseling for embryo adoption, or are you specialized? Are you the only one?
No, we are not the only one. In Iowa, we're the only connection to Nightlight. Right. We're the only, but yes, they have other folks that they've trained to do this in other states. I imagine they're for the most part covered, but if they are not covered in a state, they will actually fly to the state and take one of their own trained individuals from Colorado or California and bring them to the state to take care of the home study process and the education. And interestingly enough, they can do that, right? Because usually a home study is going to be dictated. I have to be licensed in Iowa to do that, in which we are. But because in this process, the home study is a requirement of the agency. It is not a requirement of the state, because the state does not see this as adoption. They see this as a property transfer. So therefore, the laws, the adoption laws, do not apply in that situation. So they're able to use their own well-trained individuals and send them out to states if they don't have someone like us trained to do it.
Lesbian couple came to you, would you go through the process with them?
No.
Okay.
We don't. Right. We don't do that. And so, no, and we have autonomy to be able to make those decisions, even though we're partnering with Nightlight. So they're well aware that we would not make that decision.
They can go elsewhere, though.
They could go elsewhere, and likely, I imagine, they might go through fertility clinics. And certainly, there would be other agencies such as Nightlight that could be set up that would absolutely serve that population. So there would be possibilities of that occurring, yes.
Let me plug Nightlight, which I can do, but you may not be able to do, because it's a plug for Nightlight and a backhanded slap at everybody else. As Kim pointed out, her organization, as well as Nightlight, treats embryo adoption as adoption. In other words, they proceed through the same process as a born child adoption or a traditional adoption. As far as I know, Nightlight is the only organization in the United States that approaches it that way. Every other organization that's going to broker embryo adoptions treats it more like a property transfer. And there are organizations that will do that, and there are fertility clinics who will do that, because there's no regulations. You can go directly to the fertility clinic. If the couple who has property rights to the embryos chooses to have them donated, then the fertility clinic can broker that themselves, because it's a simple property transfer. So we recommend strongly that when we talk about embryo adoption, we talk about that in the context of Nightlight and organizations like Kim's that partner with Nightlight, because we believe that these are our children from the very beginning and so ought to be treated as such. And that means going through the same process as you would if you were adopting a born child.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. A couple other points on the screen. So there may be remaining embryos. Maybe you achieve a pregnancy, maybe you do not achieve a pregnancy because implantation was not successful. If there are remaining embryos in the group that were donated, then you can attempt an additional pregnancy throughout, you know, those groups of embryos. That's essentially what's happening. Now, if no embryos were to remain and there was unsuccessful implantation and pregnancy, then a rematch process can happen through Nightlight with a different couple and a different embryo. And they do charge a fee for that, but those would be opportunities of something that could be done. And we talked about this already. If your family is complete, that it would go back to Nightlight, and so that they could be in control of where all the siblings are, and that it would that originating family would be in control of choosing an additional family. This is just my shameless plug for our Facebook page. So if you've got your smartphones out, that banner up there at the top is the one that you're looking for, because there's lots of different Lutheran Family Services in varying states. And so we'd love to have you head to our Facebook page and sign up there. So that is everything I have about embryo adoption. But you have been fantastic with questions.
This is a good question for Pastor Solomon. Are our LCMS pastors or trained to, in premarital counseling, talk about in vitro fertilization as being
big question. That is yours.
To avoid as a Christian.
I might have a little bit of an answer.
Guys, I'm really trying to bite my tongue. I have lots of stuff that I'd like to say about in vitro fertilization and embryo adoption, but it's not my place to speak. So let me try to give the simplest answer possible, which may be unsatisfactory. I wasn't, and I don't know that it is a standard part of any curriculum. However, Lutherans for Life does have an official position on in vitro fertilization. We also have an official position on embryo adoption, in case you're wondering. We are opposed to in vitro fertilization. We endorse embryo adoption, but at the same time remain opposed to in vitro fertilization.
And if I could just speak as a generic LCMS pastor, I must have picked this up at some point, because I did know about this when I went out to the parish. So, I mean, I don't know, you're right, I mean, but somewhere it got mentioned. And it may well have been because there was a Lutherans for Life rep at our seminary who spoke about it, and maybe that's where it went in my ear and lodged in my brain. Yeah.
And you're young. That's the other thing. This all develops over decades.
I know. Mm-hmm. Right.
Really, and speaking from the Texas representative, my job description is to go to Lutheran churches all over Texas, teach them about the life issues, because 99% of people think life issues are abortion only. They mm-hmm. haven't got a clue. I've got this PowerPoint that I showed at people, and I get in front of as many Lutheran pastors as I can, and they all go, you know, they never heard this before. That's what I would encourage all of you to do. Make sure your own pastor is aware of the life issues, because this is a big one that we don't even know
about.
And
it really is a tragedy, I think, that we as the Protestant church generally considered, the extent of our message to young people, especially as they're getting married, about sexuality and procreation has been, wait till you're married. But that's all the guidance we give to people. And they do a good job of following that as best as they can. But then we sort of turn them loose, and so they're like, what are we gonna do? And they turn to the culture for guidance. They say, well, we're married, we follow God's plan, so everything's okay for us. You know, it's kind of embarrassing that the Roman Catholics are far, far ahead of us in talking about these things. And so these are life issues, right? Even for us who are part of Lutherans for Life, sometimes we focus on higher profile issues, ones that we've grown comfortable being contrarian about. In vitro fertilization is one of those where it is not comfortable. It is not comfortable to stand up in a congregation and say, we have some ethical discomfort with this, because people who have sought in vitro fertilization have done so out of a deep hurt and a holy desire for that which God has promised. And some people have been successful in vitro fertilization. We certainly don't want to give any impression that their children are not pleasing in God's sight or that their family is somehow unholy. So it's uncomfortable, but that's the stuff that we do, and we've got to be bold in educating ourselves and giving guidance as well.
Yeah, firsthand experience, 13 years ago, and I can say that specifically because one of our families in our congregation went through in vitro fertilization, and of course no one knew that they were doing this, and so back in the day when I chaired our life chapter, we put articles in our bulletin. And in vitro was something we put in the bulletin. And when the terms from the Lutherans for Life brochure said, can challenge God's creation, that was in there. And our pastor learned by trial by fire, because we had the grandparents in his office, mm-hmm. we had the parents in his office, threatening to leave the church. Yeah. I mean, it's so
we've
got to
be gospel
it's
motivated.
Yes.
It is very sensitive, but again, there's... I wish I had the time. Scott wants to get us back on schedule. So I'm
sure he does. I'm really sorry.